I guess I will say I was fortunate in that I had a safe place to be. I was at the Emergency Operations Center in Charlotte County, which is obviously built to withstand the worst of storms. And even at the Emergency Operations Center, you could feel, you know, the building sort of, you know, shaking, the vibrations. You could actually see some water coming in underneath through the front door. I think the toughest thing for me that night was that my family, you know, was at home, and I was watching the eye of the storm go over our family home. It was a very difficult experience for them. Quite honestly, it was terrifying. They were literally holding the door. My husband, my stepson, and my son were literally holding the door for hours, you know, hoping that the door was going to hold. It was a terrifying night. It was a long day, I should say. A very difficult few days as we all waited to see really how bad it was. And of course, you're trying to communicate with loved ones and you can't reach them. So it's the wondering, it's the worrying.
Sandra, here in Central Florida, recovery from Hurricane Ian's flooding rains has been painfully slow in some places. What has the road to recovery been like where you are, and is it still ongoing?
Definitely. I can tell you, I'm up in Charlotte County. There are still many roofs that need to be repaired. Today, they actually just started repairing my roof, which I'm excited about. You know, in many cases, I'm one of them, dealing with insurance companies, trying to, you know, come to an agreement on what's covered. And the other dilemma is, you know, some people want to build back stronger than before. They realize that the shingle roofs that they had didn't do very well, right? And so people are thinking, okay, can I afford to build back with, let's say, a metal roof this time? Yes. And I will tell you that that process looks very different in different parts of our community. Obviously, if you go to the hardest hit areas, there are, you know, buildings are just still completely gone, completely wiped out. Construction hasn't started. Folks who are lower income still have a great deal of work to be done. I know there are volunteer organizations going into this, some of those communities, seeing how can they help support where maybe the government funding that came in wasn't enough. And quite frankly, there are people who will never be able to rebuild again. I'm speaking specifically about right now, thinking about Fort Myers Beach. There were some old cabins, you know, built out of wood. Those are completely gone. You know, when you get either government assistance or your insurance payments, it's not going to be enough to build those old homes to the standards that they have to meet now. And so some people will realize they do not have the money to rebuild again. Many of them are simply selling those properties. And essentially, Fort Myers Beach will look like a very different place because you're going to have folks who have a lot of money to come in and buy those properties. The values are still high as far as what those properties are selling at, and they're going to build some beautiful new resorts, new condos. But folks who, you know, perhaps didn't have those high incomes, they will not be able to stay in places like Fort Myers Beach.
Has the recovery there been uniform, or is it a case, as in many places after natural disasters, of an unequal recovery?
I definitely will say that those neighborhoods are definitely still struggling to figure out how they are going to build back again. Literally yesterday, we covered a group who came in from Mississippi volunteering their services, spoke to a lady who, you know, had been unable to rebuild again, and they were coming in to help her. So yes, I would say for sure those neighborhoods are struggling. And I would even say it's not just low-income families. I would say some of these middle-income families who are in places like these barrier islands, who maybe, you know, have lived there a really long time, they just won't be able to stay. There were, you know, definitely many lessons that were learned from this storm. To get these homes to the standards that they have to be at, to be able to withstand a storm like this again, you're talking enormous amounts of money. For sure, you know, some of the lessons we've learned from different groups talking about resiliency, some of the experts have come in, some of these contractors, and we know, for instance, that homes that were up built up above the ground versus right on the ground, especially on these very islands, obviously did a lot better. We know that the homes that had those shingles versus the metal roofs, those shingles did not do as well on those homes. Most of those roofs, you know, were often blown away. I can tell you in my own neighborhood, I saw it. So a lot of families are trying to come up with the money to put on metal roofs. The homes that were destroyed have to be built again to meet the standards of today.
Some infrastructure, such as the causeway connecting Sanibel to the mainland, was rebuilt quickly after Ian. But what about infrastructure designed to mitigate the impact of future storms? Has there been much conversation about how to limit the future effects of sea level rise and hurricane storm surge going forward?
Yes, those conversations are ongoing. I can tell you we've been covering them during the last few weeks. But yes, it's an ongoing conversation with leaders of these emergency operations centers, community groups that have come together to talk about how do you build back better so that there isn't total destruction again. But the truth is, these communities are being built right back in the same place where all this destruction happened. And so, of course, if you're building on a barrier island, there is vulnerability, I would say, no matter how you build. One of the things happening right now is, you know, there is still, in Charlotte County specifically, I can tell you, there was a lot of damage to seawalls throughout the community. I'm talking specifically now, for instance, about Punta Gorda, the city of Punta Gorda. They still had damage that they were repairing from a previous storm when Ian hit. Now they've got miles and miles of seawall to repair. And what was interesting, it wasn't this, you know, sudden surge of waves and high water that came. Essentially what happened was, is when Ian approached, it sort of sucked out all the water from these smaller waterways. And so you had essentially like empty canals, empty waterways. And so the pressure of the saturated land behind these walls, they started essentially to crumble because they didn't have the water on the other side to hold them up. So you have seawalls now that have to be repaired. And there is essentially a real, you know, concern, you know, to get this done as quickly as they can, hoping that they get it done before the next storm comes.
What's the sense you get, Sandra, from residents in Southwest Florida about how they're preparing for hurricane season this year? Does it feel different this time after last year's experience?
Gosh, that's a tough question. I mean, I guess I would say that we are all hopeful that we do not have anything near Hurricane Ian again anytime soon. I can just speak for my own folks in my own neighborhood and speak, you know, to my own you know, what I was going through as my own family. You know, there was a sense of, I've got to get this roof done and completed before hurricane season. And I didn't quite make the deadline, but we're getting there. Yeah, I mean, I think people definitely want to make sure that their homes, their structures are safe to be in time before the next storm hits. And I think this was a terrifying experience for so many folks who went through it. I definitely think there were lessons learned, and I do think that especially folks who, you know, made the decision to stay probably will not stay next time. They'll at least have learned the lesson how important it is to evacuate when you're so close to the water.